and welcome. You're with IndiaPostLive.com, India's first live conversation web television portal. It is an interactive portal where all of you can tell us what you feel about the issues that we are talking about. You just have to click a button to participate, or you can send us your posts, your audio comments, your video comments, and of course your tweets @@IndiaPostLive and #IndiaPostLive. Well, the conversation we are having right now is, of course, on the big story that has just happened. That is the NDA government's maiden union budget. Take a look.
NDA's maiden budget does give benefit in income tax slabs and exemption in excise duties of day-to-day use gadgets. But it seems to be running low on out-of-the-box ideas. They've launched over 24 crore schemes and allowed 49% FDI in defense and insurance. Surprising, because the BJP had opposed FDI in both sectors when they were in the opposition. The budget also keeps UPA's flagship programs in continuity. Social media was up in arms when 200 crore rupees was allocated for Sardar Patel's statue and only 150 crore rupees was allocated for women's safety, a sign of where the new government's priorities lie. With nothing new to show, this budget looks more of old wine in a new bottle.
Okay, so is it old wine in a new bottle is the question we are asking. Of course, I'm waiting for all of you to get back to me with your responses as well. But right now, joining me in the studio is Amirullah Khan, who is an economist. Thank you so much for joining the conversation. And Ijaz Ilmi, who is a leader of the BJP. Thank you so much, Ijaz, for joining the conversation. We will also have some online guests. And all of you, as I said, can participate in the conversation. Let me first ask you, sir, old wine in new bottle?
That would be making an understatement. It is a budget that really makes absolutely no sense. And the reason I'm a little more upset about the budget is that it brings up all these contradictions that your show just talked about too. You know, why these schemes? We talked about, for the last 19 months, we've been hearing about a very strong message coming from BJP, which is, we will control fiscal deficit. So we were looking for that. We were looking at measures that would show that here our expenditure is going down and this is where our revenues are going to go up.
Right.
No such sign. It criticized Chidambaram like nobody's business for obfuscating the fiscal deficit in his interim budget. Does the same again. You read the budget and you find that there is absolutely no direction. The only direction that comes out is that we will focus a lot on the defense sector. Now, that's a strange thing that is going around. One of the first things that this government did was, and that was, you know, in every which way, something that we all thought was a good measure, which was invite all the neighbors. Now, here is a strange thing. I don't understand it as an economist. Maybe the geopolitical strategists will tell you better. That, you know, if you extend hands of friendships to neighbors, do you then spend crores of money arming yourself? What is the signal you are sending?
Okay.
$38 billion on the defense budget, right? Less than $6 billion on health. Where are our priorities? So if you look at the budget, and you know, yesterday I was not as unhappy with the budget as I am today.
Why?
Because I read it over the overnight.
I
hope I don't come back tomorrow. Right? But really, I mean, granted that the finance minister had very little time, granted that he is somebody who is handling everything in the government he's doing.
Yeah,
you know,
and that's
obvious. So I was wondering, is this a finance minister reading a budget or is a defense minister reading a budget?
Okay.
I didn't get it. So granted, all those things granted, new government, 45 days, all of that. But you've been saying so many things for such a long time. And the worst thing is when you send conflicting signals. That is when people get confused.
Okay, let me ask Ijaz.
Okay, he's quite upset. He wasn't so upset yesterday. He's more upset today.
I
wonder what day after foretells. but let me tell you, going through the fine print and seeing various aspects of the budget, and I'm not an economist to boot anyway, but as somebody who understands this nation and who's a political worker, all I can say is that the difference between this budget and the UPA's budget, between Mr. Jaitley's budget and Mr. Chidambaram's budget, the content and the intent is totally clear in Mr. Jaitley's budget. You know, people actually believe that all announcements made by the UPA and even in the interim budget when they passed over 1 lakh crores and of deferred payment, a lot of the intention was lacking. Out here, the intent is very, very clear that you understand that the GST has to be, you can only do it if in consonance by taking the states along. So Mr. Jaitley clearly said, I need to get everybody on board. And the intent is to get a GST in by next year by getting everybody on board. The Team India in the BJP manifesto was not only Narendra Modi and his top cabinet ministers. They spoke about Team India means every chief minister being on board of Team India. You have to take the states along. So there are certain parameters. And besides that, besides the content and intent, what is very important to understand, FDI in defense and insurance. If you're going to bring in more money, there's limited money within the nation. You need to kickstart, re-energize, reignite, and revitalize the economy. You need funds coming in. And if funds are coming in, if they're better managed and better controlled, it's very, very clear. Promoting growth, tightening fiscal deficit, controlling fiscal deficit, as well as keeping track of fiscal consolidation. These are the three mantras. It's very difficult, but the challenge given out by the government is the challenge to themselves that we accept it. It's a challenging situation to turn around the economy, but we intend to turn around the economy.
All right.
That's the single most important message.
Okay, so the message is that you intend, the BJP intends, the government intends to turn around the economy. Let's quickly take a look at, you know, the broad aspects of what the budget really means for all of us. What has got cheaper and what has become more expensive for the common man? That is coming up on your screens right now, as you see. Okay, so these are the things that are become more expensive, yes, for you. And now let's take a look at what is more cheap. Wow, that's good news. That's good news too.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, all right. So there we have it. Broadly, have I managed to bring back some cheer? No.
No. These are, you see, this is what I mean.
Yeah.
For an economist who's been pretty disappointed with the UPA budgets for so long.
Yeah.
What we were looking for was,
yes, what were you
clear,
really expecting?
A clear,
yeah,
signal. Huh. We wouldn't like this tinkering. You see, one of the things that we've been opposed with is, why do finance ministers do this tinkering? You know, why do you have 10% up here, 5% down there, with no basis, right? You know, the joke going around is that cigarettes are expensive, matchboxes are cheaper. So you're where you were, right? But, you know,
yeah,
the thing
have you seen what's doing the rounds on social media? You have like this engagement ring thingy, and instead of a ring, you have a cigarette in it. You know, it's amazing. And then you have a box of cigarettes,
well,
which says EMI options available.
but what is more interesting is that cigarette smoking is injurious to health.
Yes, it's
now
injurious
it's to
wealth. Exactly.
Yeah,
that,
so,
no, but you know what the serious issue there is?
Yeah.
8 times more people in India smoke bidis.
Yeah.
That price hasn't gone up. So if we are talking about tobacco and tobacco use, then we have to first increase the cost of bidis or make them illegal. Something like, we see.
No, making them
No, no, why I'm saying that is that here was a government with this 56-inch chest, which said we will do anything possible. Did nothing. That is the problem. If
all
it
right.
was again doing those tinkering, then I'm a little worried.
I mean. The impetus on kickstarting the infrastructure, the roads outlay, the fact is that you are doing so much in the social sector for the first time, cleaning up rivers, sanitation, potability of water, and reaching out to the social sector. These things haven't been done in real earnest. Secondly, linking MGNREGA to asset creation with an agricultural tint towards it, in terms of allocation of funds, you will push up the non-farm rural job market. You know, the methods to kickstart the economy and different aspects. Secondly, the impetus on IT, from being an IT, ITS-enabled nation to IT manufacturing. It's a paradigm growth, which is very, very important.
Let me argue a little bit for Ajaz. You're
arguing for him.
For him now.
Huh, huh.
The, you're right. What is nice there is that there is this little emphasis on entrepreneurship. There is this little emphasis, mark little, on training. But you know, on internet connectivity, it is a great line. But then you do the 100 crore bit. So what you do is that
the NCP has in fact said that this budget will
benefit only the... No, it will not benefit anybody.
Let me bring in some online responses now, please. Okay, we have Vinita Deshmukh who joins us from Pune. Ma'am, good morning and welcome to the conversation. How are you? Can you hear me? Okay, I cannot hear her.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I got you there. Ma'am, very quickly, your first response on the budget.
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now, Vinita. Ma'am, your first response on the budget. Is it old wine in a new bottle is what we're asking.
Firstly, I'd just like to say that I'm not a financial journalist, so I'm looking at it as an individual and as a citizen.
Absolutely.
And what I feel is that it is totally addressed to the middle class, which has voted in large numbers for the NDA government. And secondly, the budget looks at a very micro level, and it does not give a macro picture, but it's just tried to please everybody, like saying that Jaitley actually behaved like a father of a bride on a reception day when he gave a diverse menu to please each and every guest, and similarly here, each and every citizen. And I just think that there have been some thoughtless things that have been born into it.
Hmm.
So I'm not going to into all those fiscals and taxes and all that. But just imagine that they have provided something like 38,000 crore rupees for investment in national highways, when the national highways has been a big disaster, especially in Maharashtra. So there is no reference to the background of its performance, and so much of money has been put into it. And
right.
On top of that, 8,500 kilometers have to be done in this current fiscal year, when they have been done absolutely a shoddy job. Similar with PPPs. They are also
okay.
In a sham. Now, 3,000 crore rupees for modernization of police force. However, in various states, even the national police reform haven't come. Now, 12.2 lakh crore rupees are on fertilizer subsidies and additional fertilizer. But what is the kind of environment that they have created? There is nothing for the environment, for sustainability. It is only development, development, development. And that is so. I guess the corporate sector would be really happy. But I wish there was a balance. There is no balance between environment and development, which is so crucial in today's era of 21st century.
Fine, ma'am. Thank you so much. Please hang in. We'll now get Mr. Vijay Grover online. He joins us from Bangalore. Senior journalist. Vijay sir, thank you so much for joining the conversation. You just heard Vinita ma'am, and of course I'm sure you heard Mr. Amirullah and Ijaz.
He's my former colleague.
He's your former colleague.
Yeah, Vijay, yes.
Great.
Yes.
Okay, so while you say hello to each other, perhaps we'll get your response, and then the two of you can argue, if at all. Sir, your response.
See, as far as the budget is concerned, certainly it could have done a lot better. The kind of policy paralysis that we saw in the UP in the last couple of years was something which clearly reflected on the economic policies of the government, a reason why the UPA was sent out by the people.
Hmm.
But there were no pressures as far as Narendra Modi government is concerned, or Arun Jaitley has, that he had to tie his hands down. And one cannot but understand that this was after having given an early warning signal where a better bill was proposed. Unfortunately, no direction seems to be there in the budget as far as this is concerned. Clearly, it is a budget where efforts have been made to placate a lot of corporates which backed BJP's campaign. And this is something which is very clearly standing out in this budget, that certain industrial houses which had backed the BJP's campaign, or we can call it Narendra Modi's campaign, have been rewarded with certain reliefs. And that's something which is clearly a signal of the days to come, certainly not for the common man. And that's something which is a very big worry, because development is fine, you know, but development at what cost, as Vinita Deshmukh very clearly reflected, that development at what cost are we looking at? And that's certainly going to be a big challenge, because people certainly will see through the kind of game, because the nexus that is coming out openly, the corporate political nexus, is a very dangerous trick.
All right. Ijaz, it seems that you're the only one left to defend it.
No, I will defend it, because I'm very, very clear. Even I've done a thorough reading of this.
Yeah.
What was earlier coming out from the UPA's table was dole-based and right-based economic doles given out to various sections and the poorest of the poor. Now it's just linked, it's become outcome-based. You linking Manrega to asset creation, providing money for sanitation, toilets, clean water, cleaning up the Ganga. These are all linked with livelihoods of the common people. Increasing employability in non-farm jobs by linking Manrega is one aspect. Secondly, if you kickstart and give a boost to infrastructure, give a boost to the real estate investment cycle, which has been languishing for 7 years, and real estate is one of the largest employment generation situations in the country, having 100 smart cities, textile clusters. These are all situations which can only enhance employability and employment, which is very, very important to fill a common man's stomach.
I want to talk about the 100 smart cities, but a little later. First, let's take a look at this, the graphic. The tax slabs has been increased to 2.5 for the ordinary citizen and 3 lakhs for senior citizens. And the savings bar is 1.5 lakhs. But however, despite all of that, Mr. Jaitley is claiming that there is going to be revenue. So let's take a look at how the government is expecting to earn. Okay, it is talking of, we are talking in crores. That's 2,84,266 is what is estimated revenues from the income tax. How do you think this can actually come about, you know, with all these SOPs given? These are SOPs, a particular SOP. Okay, as an economist.
Figures are simple, and this is not such a, it's not something that is surprising at all.
Mm-hmm.
He's done that calculation very well.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen is that given a 4.5-5% increase or a 5.5 as the government is claiming in GDP, this kind of an increase in income tax revenue is not at all difficult. The reason I am not happy with what was done was that there was no reason for these exemptions. You see, at a time, we are very clear that we are at a very difficult time. Arun Jaitley made this clear, the survey made it clear that it's a tough time. We have to match our revenues and expenditure. You know, roughly, for the audience, roughly India earns about 12 lakh crore rupees, right, from income tax and non-direct tax and disinvestment and all that. What we spend is roughly 18 to 19 lakh crores. So we have a deficit of 6.5 lakh crores. If you start that off by cutting down on incomes, then you are increasing the pressure of that deficit. That 4.1% cannot be met. It will not be met. It will be a very sorry finance minister next year saying that, you know, I couldn't do it. So that is why. That's why this was not required.
So how are they calling it a growth-oriented budget?
You know, what has been done is some amount of lip service given to manufacturing.
Okay.
Now, it is true worldwide what we argue, or China argues very well, that manufacturing is good to raise employment. And we have been worried about jobs, 100 million jobs we need, all of that is true. But you know, the Indian industry is not a manufacturing sector. India doesn't have comparative advantages in manufacturing. If we keep chasing that, which is what this government is starting to do, then we'll make the same mistakes and we'll come back 4 years later saying, sorry, we needed 100 million jobs, we created 7 million. So that is the problem, that it's saying the right thing. But it is not doing it. The one example I would like to give to everybody is that this government said, we will be very clear about fiscal deficits, we'll bring them down. Right? They said subsidies are bad, doles are bad, we will not give them. And you know what they do? They increase the subsidy on urea. It is the most bizarre contradiction that one can see.
Let me just clarify that the finance minister in his statement clearly said that we have subsidies in this nation, and you can't wish the subsidies
away. Why increase
them? But to make it target based in the future,
by enhancing, by making
it auditable. If the subsidy is targeted by an auditable, obviously
that's a great line.
The figure will come down. The figure will come down because right now, look at the pilferage, the leakage that is going on in the various ways, this PDS, or because you are not able to target it. It's a random free for all. But if you have a target based subsidy based on Aadhaar, the clear identification and which is auditable in a social mechanism, then obviously the subsidy will come down because the pilferage will come down and the leakage will come down.
Let's see what the common man is saying. Mr. Vijay Grover, I'll just get back to you. Just give me a minute, okay? Let me first get you voices of the people from the streets out there. You all are, of course, experts, but what the common man has, you know, the first reaction of the common man to the budget, let's take a look at some of those that we have.
बोले आप जो चीज मैं बेचता था 35 रुपए का या 25 रुपए का जो बेचता था आज 25 रुपए का खरीदारी आ रहा घटना चाहिए रेट
बजट ने तो हमारा बजट निकाल दिया जी इट वाज बेटर टू हैव द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ द कांग्रेस इंस्टेड ऑफ हैविंग द मोदी सरकार
वी जस्ट वांट टू लिव लाइफ इजी
द न्यू गवर्नमेंट हैज कम द प्राइसेस शुड गो डाउन एट एट
इनकम टैक्स लिमिट शुड बी एट लीस्ट 5 लाख
कार्य मोदी का बढ़िया दिख रहा है अभी तो आगे पीछे देखो क्या होता है
We were also expecting that housing loan will get some kind of benefit, you know.
Health problems should be...
Housing. Yeah, of course, housing.
Should reduce, the price should be reduced.
All right, so those were some voices. Someone saying, let's wait and watch, let's give Mr. Modi some time. But a lot of people saying that, you know, prices are not coming down. Because that was, in fact, this whole euphoria that happened when the Modi government came was that immediately prices would go down. And yeah, that I think, you know, to the man on the street.
Unfair promise to make. That's an unfair promise.
That is, okay, Mr. Grover had something to say. Sir, you had, I think, something to respond to Ijaz.
As Ijaz was pointing out very clearly that, you know, subsidies need to be targeted, and that's where the BJP is now going to realize the virtues of things which it had opposed tooth and nail when it was in the opposition. No doubt BJP is the best opposition party that the country can have ever. And that's something which they will now realize that sitting in the benches, that they're going to have a tough task because they opposed Aadhaar, they opposed stricter norms for MGNREGA, and this is going to be a huge task. I'm glad that 2,000 crores has been sanctioned for continuation of Aadhaar. But more than just the sanctions, what will now be needed is a stronger political will to link DBT with Aadhaar. And that's going to be a huge task, given the fact that the BJP had opposed it. Yes. It will now have to accept that, yes, Aadhaar was a good project and it should be continued. It will have to politically maybe eat a humble pie, but in the interest of the country and for controlling subsidies, that's something that they will have to do it at the earliest to ensure that 60 crore more Aadhaar cards are given out in the next 2 years so that everybody is under scrutiny, and then link LPG and other subsidies, which are a huge burden and disturb the entire economy, to be linked through Aadhaar. And that's something which would be a positive way forward to be able to ensure that subsidies are not misused.
Okay, let me bring in Vinita ma'am here. Vinita ma'am, you know, after everything that we have heard, you know, do you think at the end of this, do you think inflation will go down as the government is promising?
There's a lag.
Pardon, could you just repeat it because I can't hear you.
Okay, I asked about inflation. Do you think inflation will come down? That is a huge issue that when the NDA was in the opposition, they kept talking about inflation. With this budget, do you think inflation will come down?
Well, you know, it depends on how it is going to be implemented. The whole implementation process is going to be important to know whether the inflation is going to come down, because they have repeated some things. For example, those 100 smart cities for which they have given 7,000 crore rupees is something equal to the GNNURM, wherein those 60 cities have been identified. The point is that, I don't know, they've just tried to put everything into the bag. But like I said, there is no reference. They have not studied the looks at the history, and they have not, we don't know how they are going to implement. And hence, therein lies the mystery of whether the inflation is going to, you know, come down.
Okay.
I'd like to just add one thing.
Yeah.
I just like to add,
even in agriculture.
Ma'am, 1 second. Ijaz has a response.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, I'm saying it. We all agree it's a difficult economic scenario that the government has inherited. This wasn't a part B of an interim budget, which you already had one in March because of elections. There's 8 months to the fiscal year. I think don't doubt the intent, because the intent is to actually sit down, work hard and deliver. The same intent which, I mean, there were a lot of skeptics who could never believe that Mission 272 plus was possible. But the BJP, by sheer hard work, and it made it possible. So the devil is in the detail is about implementation. I'm trying to say to you is that we intend to implement everything that is stated, and the intention is very, very clear.
All right. You talked of implementation.
Yes.
We have a video response from a Supreme Court advocate, Mr. Pradeep Rai. And let's hear what he has had to say about the budget.
It's a good budget prepared by all the three secretaries of the finance ministry. I personally feel that the actual part of the finance ministry is to implement the budget. Whenever a budget comes with the help of the ministry officials or from the fields of the corporates, it has to be implemented properly. If you implement it like in excise department, they have raised the taxes on gutka and cigarette and all. But you have to actually check the production. If you collect the taxes as per production, there is no need of either taxes. And then you can also give various privileges to the common man.
All right, so he's talking of controlling, you know, taking steps to control the production and to ensure that the taxes, you know, because apparently the actual figures are not really coming in what can.
Sure. So there is a lot of tax evasion in the country, and there is no doubt that it will continue. And that is where, again, you know, my peeve in this budget is that where is the intent? You talked so much about retrospective taxes, right? The whole thing was about how we'll do it tomorrow, right? You expected that 17th May, retrospective tax would go. It was such a bad thing. And yesterday, the finance minister says it's a good thing. That we will, that it should not be removed. It is a strange thing. It is really this kind of confusion that everybody is worried about. That, you know, we all elected a new government because it was pointing out what was wrong about policy earlier. We don't want for it to continue saying what was done was wrong. We want it to change things, and certainly we don't want the same policies continued in the new government.
Can we also talk about the FDI, FDI in defence? Of course, Mr. A.K. Antony has said it's bad for the security of the country, and of course that's been
but
a reaction.
That's a very Congress type of
thing. Yeah, that's a political reaction.
FDI is very welcome. If we want really, and as Jasper rightly put it, if we want the sector to grow, if we want the growth to come back, we need a lot of capital infusion. We've had a decrease in capital formation, and this will be a lot of capital that will come in. The worry is not about that. The worry is this quibbling. Why 49%? I mean, you know, you discourage people. Serious technology transfer only happens when you give me 70, 75, 100% limits. If you allow me 49, and if some local person is the majority holder, I will never transfer technology. And in defense, it is all about very serious technology transfer.
Of course.
Similarly with insurance. I don't know why. Again, you know, what we wanted in this budget, I'm saying that we are being very lenient to this government. We understand that it is very little time. But we want them to just put in what they have said. What they have said over the last, at least the last 19 months. They've told us that they will allow FDI. Now, by tinkering it and increasing it from 24 to 49, you are where you were. I'm telling you, what will happen is that nobody will come. You see, whatever sectors we will allow, take FDI in retail. One, I don't understand this bizarre reason why BJP doesn't like FDI in retail. Everything else is okay. The simplest sector we will not allow. So, I don't know. They've never explained the reasons. If they are now going the other end and allowing FDI in things like defense and whatever, you know what will happen? FDI is something where serious investors come and invest in a country because they see potential.
So do you think there will not be any technology transfer with
I just complete the sentence. The point I'm making is that in sectors like insurance, defense and railways, which are the three big sectors we've been hearing about the last 3 days, you know, there is no regulator. Why will I invest in money in a railways that has no accountability? You are asking me to come and invest. There is an Indian Railways Act that is 100 years old.
Yes.
That is a monopoly that doesn't allow me to do anything with prices. And whatever prices you increase, you roll back. So if you give these signals, why will FDI come? And again, 2 years later, you will say that only one fellow came with a little money, like in retail, and went back.
Why will FDI come?
I'll tell you why FDI will come in insurance and defense and in railways.
With 49.
There are a lot of pitfalls. Which you need an enabling mechanism by various acts needing to be amended. But the intent is, and I have no doubt, on the Indian multinationals, some of the very reputed companies in India itself have done great jobs in adding value, in being growth enablers, in being job creators.
Yeah, but FDI.
Obviously, their track record for 30, 40, 50, 100 years, we have companies in India who are 150 years old also. We have a track record of companies who done exemplary work in India, and yes, look, there's no growth potential for international companies where they exist in Europe and USA. The emerging market is India. So everybody would like to have a manufacturing base in India to cater to India.
Why not 74%?
Let's take a quick look at what is there for the industry in this budget. In fact, Indian companies pay income tax at rates similar to its global peers. So let's take a quick look. We have a graphic on that. And then you can comment on that. But before we wrap up the show, there is one question that I'm itching to ask all of you, which I will. Okay, that's the statistic, global tax comparison for industries vis-a-vis other countries. And you see that, you know,
we don't do badly at all. Our problem is not our tax rate. Our problem is the complication.
Right.
You see, we make it so difficult for people
code
to
itself,
pay
yes,
tax.
Absolutely.
That is why this signal is wrong. If we had removed this retrospective taxation, it would have sent a very good signal to foreign industry.
In fact, let's also take a look at some of the things that have come in the social media regarding this budget.
Yes, sure.
And like you said, like Mr. Vijay Grover said, old wine in a new bottle. A lot of people think that it is very similar to the UPA's budget. And these are the memes that have been doing the rounds on Facebook and WhatsApp. UPA accuses NDA, is this yours? You know, the copycat budget, as they are calling it. Trust me, it's NDA's budget. So these are things that are doing the rounds.
It's like the railway hike, you know, finally we were told it was UPA's doing.
I need to talk to you about that 100 smart cities.
Yeah.
As soon as we finish this, before we wrap up the show, there are finer points, read properly. Okay, so that's like, yahi karna tha, to main kya buri thi? These are things that are really doing the rounds. It is important to obviously infuse some humor into everything.
Absolutely,
all these serious
yes.
issues also. And that's what social media is doing for all of us.
Yeah.
For a government, the economy is work in progress. Absolutely, yes.
Sure.
It's the intent and the ability to implement your views and,
right.
and what you propose, what really matters.
All right.
Yes.
So, okay, no, I just want to ask
but
you
smart
one
smart cities
thing.
Is a very good idea.
Which one?
The smart city idea.
Smart
You've
city.
Been asking this question.
I have been asking. I just want to ask you one thing. You remember I was asking you this question even during the rail budget discussion.
Yes.
The toilets.
Yes.
In my city, a woman, you know, there are no toilets every few miles.
Yeah.
And you're talking of 100 smart cities.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you plan to implement this? How do you plan to really
you know
make
what,
it work?
This Swachh
it's a great
Bharat
idea.
Thing
I love
is a
it.
Very good idea. I see two problems there.
Yeah.
One is that we still have about 600 million people defecating in the open. Right? 78 million households, which means at least 78 million toilets. If we are targeting then by 2019, maybe we are
so do you think what
Ijaz
talked about, Narega with acid
If they
acid
do
pollution?
That, that will be a super thing because it will
okay.
have a huge externality on the health impact.
Absolutely.
And I think that's a great step. There isn't anything in this
budget.
Do you
budget
think
it's practical? Do you think it's feasible?
We will have to wait and see how the Ministry for Drinking Water and Sanitation takes this up because this
okay.
is not the finance minister's job, really.
Right.
He's
right.
done the right thing by saying this should be done.
All right. Let me take a final comment from Vinita Deshmukh before we wrap up. Ma'am, we have tried to touch on various aspects of the budget. We've tried to touch upon FDI,
yeah.
smart cities. Your final comments, ma'am.
My final comment is that although I've been making some adverse remarks, if certain things are implemented, surely it would be good for the country. And like I said earlier, y'all have been discussing that for me, the biggest thing is sanitation by 2019.
Yeah.
Because that itself is going to uplift women. Because I've worked closely on these issues in Maharashtra.
Right.
And I know how even in rural areas or urban slum areas, girls are getting educated. And this open toilet concept is making them depressed and psychologically
yes.
and curbing them from getting educated also.
Right.
So I think for me that is the biggest thing.
Absolutely.
And second is the 1-2-3 plantation as a...
All right. I think we lost it.
Okay, I think there's a problem there, but okay, we get your. Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. We.
I just
like to. I thought the road and that PPP and the smart cities. I'm a little bit wary.
All right. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much for joining the conversation.
I was just like to show Vinita what she said about. This government is definitely sensitive. And sensitive in terms of real issues like women empowerment,
yes.
the girl child,
yes.
the gender disparity and sex ratio. There is concern and an impetus has been given this time to address these issues. The intent of the government is absolutely clear that these issues needs to be exploited and a manifold exponential increase. The intent is there. If you start something, if you start somewhere, you can only build upon it. And that's what this budget is all about.
It is very true.
Yes.
The thing is that, you know, intent is not
the
being doubted. We voted
key.
340 of you because we respect that intent. Now we don't want to look at intent. Now we want to see how you do
steps
it.
Steps on the
and
ground.
That
ground,
is why,
on the ground.
And
how,
that is
how
why,
it rolls out. How
no, how it rolls out in the budget
right.
speech.
We
and it did not.
Okay, we will have to wrap up the conversation here. The conversation, of course, continues on IndiaPostLive.com through your posts, your tweets, your audio comments and video comments. Of course, this is a huge, many announcements have been made and it is up to, it's a wait and watch, I think, for many of us, economists like you, social activists and journalists like Vijay sir and Vinita ma'am, and of course, all of you as well. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.